A very good morning to the audience here, and remember we have a very prestigious panel here, the ones with land bank, the ones with money in the bank, all the expertise and everything is right here, and the ones also controlling the markets. So we have all the information right here. It's for us to really take it out. So let's kickstart this interesting conversation with Anuj Puri, a longtime friend. Why don't you set the agenda, Anuj? We have spoken so much about infrastructure and real estate. These two sectors haven't participated that well in the stock market euphoria that we have seen, while the rest of the sectors have. While we have so many good things happening, like Pradhan Mantri's Awas Yojana, Smart Cities, Amrut, Hriday, Make in India, then Real Estate Act coming into play, GST on the verge of a rollout, REITs and InvITs, relaxation in FDI and ECB norms. So many good things happening. But still, the perception in this sector is not as robust. What is it that needs to be done at this point to really bring out the buoyancy in the sector?
I think it's a very important point that you touch on, Nisha. It is that the perception in this sector is really negative at this moment. A lot of people ask is that, you know, when is it going to come out of this troubled waters? I think it will. And some of the micro markets, as we go through the discussion, you'll find it have started to come out. Certainly, I think this market, Mumbai market, I feel, has started to come out. The last two quarters, we are seeing positive data. Unsold inventory is starting to contract. Mm-hmm. I think the major thing is going to be the consolidation, which perhaps is going to be the theme as we go on. And you're going to see that getting catalyzed by the Real Estate Regulation Act, where you're going to see the weaker developers getting out of this and the stronger developers getting full control, who had the financial discipline, who had the wherewithal to be able to provide the right customer-centric approach to the consumer.
Can I interrupt and add to what Anuj said?
Yes.
Two points I would like to add. I think many people ask me also the same question, that when will real estate, in brackets residential, come back? I have a very different take on it. I always ask a question back, that do you believe that this Indian economy will come back? And everybody raises their hand, it will come back. But people forget that the main weightage for the growth of economy is the real estate. So obviously real estate has to come back. So actually there is no question about it.
Yeah.
The second point which Anuj you made, rightly so, I will not say what you said is absolutely right, that many developers did. Basically, it's a very basic industry which we didn't follow the basic, the rules of the game. And that's why the developers got themselves into problems. But I would also like to add here that in the last 3 years, if I would minus the last 1.5 years, but before that, it's also the other stakeholder, which is the government, to blame. Because the approvals took 2 to 3 years. And the cost of funds don't stop. You know, the interest is not stopping. So I would also blame the other stakeholder for the mess which has been created. Because we always talk about the developer is not delivering. But if you don't get approvals, how will you deliver? So I would add these 2 points to that.
Oh, great, Khushru. Very important point. So the only developer that we have here is going to represent the entire industry for us. Vikas, do you think first it's been a little harsh to paint the entire sector with one brush that greed has overtaken, because there is a large unorganized market for which the organized market is also probably taking the brunt? And the second bit about government's take in that, you have to protect your margins as well to do the business.
See, I tend to agree with Anuj that greed at some point has taken over, and you have to understand the psyche of the customer. That when he's buying a house, he's writing the biggest check of his life. You know, he spends more money buying a house than he would do to, do anything, be it a car. Literally the entire amount he spends for his children's education to all the household stuff that he buys in his entire life could be one amount, and buying the house is the other one. So obviously you have to understand the sentiments of the buyer, and unless and until you're able to address that bit, you're not going to get him back as such. So obviously there is merit in what you're saying, that you have to differentiate between a professional developer and probably a fly-by-night developer. Here again, these are all driven by market. Obviously the customer sees that an unorganized developer probably will give an apartment a lot cheaper than a professional developer would. So, you know, greed has to be at both ends. It cannot only be ascertained to a developer. It has to go even for the customer. Customer also needs to pick his developer as such.
Okay, I take that point, but you have also views on inventory, because experts do suggest that there is an inventory built up in the real estate sector.
So here again, you know, Anuj touched upon briefly about the commercial sector coming back. We stopped building offices almost from 2010 and 11, you know, including us. We almost converted our office buildings into resi because the commercial market kept you know, going down. Today, obviously, there is lack of supply there, and there is enough demand. Mm-hmm. I don't know whether the demand has increased or probably there is lack in supply of office space. Similarly, when you look at residential, you know, it's very intriguing to see what really is supply. Today, our project in Borivali, it's literally at a stage where we are doing our foundation, but it's considered as inventory. How can a project which is literally on ground be considered as inventory? And probably, you know, these signals that go out into the market and confuse the customer. When the customer reads the paper, he thinks that, oh, there are so many unsold apartments. He fails to appreciate the fact that 90% of what he's looking at as an inventory does not really exist. These have yet to go through this process of what Khushru said, that, you know, approvals have yet to be obtained. The entire development has to take place, for which either you need to sell or you need to raise finances for it to do that, which both don't seem to be very easy. So the basic question is that, are we also giving the right data to the market? Unless and until the market knows that there really isn't that sort of supply, people will then probably come forward and buy also.
All right, so the analysis and the data and the way it is read also is to some extent faulty, which could be really causing more perception issues for the sector as well. Market really has seen a very big bull run because of the amount of liquidity that is really coming in the stock exchanges, stock markets. But real estate infrastructure has really not participated in that. Now we are on the verge of REITs and InvITs. How do you see this as an opportunity, and what else can be done to develop this market for fundraising and for the exchanges to really make profits out of the sector as well?
Basically, what we specialize in as an exchange is to basically standardize things. So in exchange, you can buy, sell very, very fast. In real estate, it will take you months. Go to sort of some office where you need to put thumbprints and all. In BSE, when you place an order, you get a response in 6 microseconds. In 1 second, there are a million microseconds. So we give you a response at 150,000th of a second. And so what you are talking about is basically bullock cart versus rockets. You know, so we need to go in that framework. But why? See, what we deal with is what I call stock. It's called stock market. It's basically stock. And stock can be of anything. What produces something else? So we deal in, say, equities, which gives you returns in terms of profits and all. And similarly, we deal in bonds. We also deal in many, many instruments like mutual funds and IPOs and so on and so forth, derivatives. But as I think Mr. Puri said, real estate has been an enigma. It has not been standardized in India specifically. The REITs started in US in 1960s, and we have not yet brought it in. And for us, how do we provide all the different asset classes to the investors? So we have provided equities, we have provided derivatives, we have provided mutual funds, bonds, equity derivatives, currency derivatives, interest rate derivatives. But real estate is like what I call a play which is a little off, because you may invest in the real estate company as an equity holder, but that's not exactly investing into real estate. So these REITs and InvITs both are very important for us. And when you start doing it on exchanges, literally you can buy 1,000 rupees of real estate. Today, where will you be able to buy 1,000 rupees of real estate except when the newspaper ad comes for buying in some plantations which probably may never exist. But effectively, when you do it on an exchange, It is basically a very organized activity. You are able to move in and out faster. There is a lot of liquidity. And what you basically go in for is for yield, in case you want to go for that kind of framework. And so REITs and InvITs are very, very sort of interesting activities for us. Today I get a lot of exchanges from abroad, like Singapore or London, wanting to come understand our REITs market, which is not yet developed, saying that we want to sort of list your REITs and so on and so forth. So as BSE has basically for 140 years, we have just done trading, but it's for investments. And this is real investments. Almost three-fourths of any country's market or in any country's stock is the real estate. And if you can bring that market into the exchanges, it will allow more funds to come into the real estate market, but also allow investors to feel more comfortable sort of investing in that product.
Oh yes, Ashish, in fact, a lot of foreign investors are also scouting around and trying to understand our REITs and InvITs, which is still developing. Kushru, we see very quickly, do we see enough interest in this area from investors?
No, absolutely. I think especially on the REITs, I can speak, if we iron out a few last few stamp duty issues and taxation issues, I think actually REITs is a game changer. Because as Ashish rightly mentioned, you are then giving an opportunity for a retail investor to even put 1,000 rupees, just for simplicity's sake, into a product which is backed by actual assets and which is rental yielding. So I think it will be a game changer, actually, for the markets.
Okay, so the commercial real estate space, as Anuj rightly pointed out, has really picked up. And REITs will really cater to that particular space. Let's broad-base the discussion into the infrastructure space as well, and InvITs are also coming in. And Sanjay is here from Mumbai Port Trust. Sanjay, a lot of real estate experts and developers do ask, when is Mumbai Port Trust going to free up land to bring down the shortage? Of course, you have huge infrastructure plans at this point. What are the plans at your end, and how soon do we see those developments really kicking in?
Okay, first, we are not thinking of pure real estate at all. So let me be very clear on that.
Yes.
We have about 745 hectares of land, which is the eastern side of Mumbai. Out of that, about 300 is going to be continue to utilized for port operations. And we are bringing out about 450 to 500 hectares for various kind of iconic developments which are required for the city. So Mumbai city, as you know, has tremendous aspirations. It is congested, it does not have open spaces, it does not have gardens, it doesn't have a convention center, it doesn't have a marina. So we are focusing on those things in this area. What we have recently done is that we have invited, a number of reports had been received on what is required to be done. But we had not prepared detailed plans on that. With engineering designs. So I've recently invited international tenders for appointing a consultant who can prepare a detailed plan for this area. And out of that, out of 450, about 150 hectares is purely in our possession. Rest of it is in leases which will keep coming back during the next 4 or 5 years. And it's also in litigation. So what you will actually see in Mumbai is an iconic development taking place in that 150 hectares of land. Second thing which we are doing is we are coming up with a huge marina project with an entertainment hub behind it. If anybody is aware of the port area, port has an Indira dock, it has got a Princess dock, and it has got a Victoria dock. We are changing the Princess Dock and Victoria Dock into a marina and related development hub, which is going to be a restaurants, entertainment, etc. But I have still to work on the connectivity to the eastern freeway for this. Third thing, which is a major focus for us, which is also going to change partly the economy and will also probably affect the real estate, is we are making Mumbai as the gateway to international cruise. Till date, all of you have been going abroad to take cruises, and now the cruises will start coming here. In fact, they had a number of issues. There was no certainty of berth, There were ousting charges. There were no SOPs for immigration, security, customs. These issues have been resolved. And in the next 1 year itself, 59 cruise ships are coming to Mumbai port and are going to use it as a home port. Per se, cruise is not a very good business for a port. A container business is a much better business. About 4 or 5 times it gives the earnings. But it affects the economy of the city. So we are encouraging that. And in fact, the first major ship is going to come on 29th October. It's a Ganting ship. We're going to have a big occasion. It's a 19-floor first-time ship which is coming here. So you will see a lot of changes taking place in Mumbai in the next few years. I also have another hat. I am the chairman of the Indian Ports Association.
Yes.
At the national level, a lot of changes are taking place in the shipping and the port sector. It's almost getting revolutionized in the last 2 years. There is a Sagarmala project which you would have heard of.
Yes.
Where every port there is going to be another SEZ or a city developed, logistic issues resolved. And we are expecting about an investment of about 4 lakh crores in this area, which is happening. In fact, I have some statistics which are very, very amazing.
Which is a timeline of that would be what?
Timeline is up by 2025, everything will be in place. New ports, modernization of the ports, logistics, the new SEZs, new industrial areas near the ports, and also something for the community.
Yes.
For example, the fishing harbors. By the way, I didn't mention it, but we are completely revamping the Sassoon docks. So the Mumbai residents who are sitting and staying in that area, who keep getting the smell of the fish, in about a year and a half, everything will be very different in that area. It's becoming a tourist hub in about 1.5 to 2 years' time.
All right. So great plans in store.
I can see a lot of Colaba citizens here.
So will this all infrastructure make Colaba even more expensive than what it is?
It will, because what has been happening is everybody has been shifting to BKC. Once this eastern side again comes into play, probably the south regains its importance because all the seafront, waterfront is on that side.
A lot is happening on the smart city front. Some of the developers are already involved. How do you see this space really developing? Is it going to give a fillip to real estate and infra?
Well, you know, these are early days, I would say, for smart city. And for once, I would say that, you know, when you're planning a smart city, infrastructure will lead, you know, development. All across, you've seen, I mean, you know, today we are talking about metros in Mumbai. We're probably 100 years late. You know, cities are first getting established and then infrastructure follows. Whereas when you look at smart cities, they're talking about infrastructure first coming in place and then cities getting built. So obviously one is very hopeful. It's the pet project for our Prime Minister. And so we'll clearly see a lot of focus from the government for it to succeed. I mean, we're all for it. We're hoping that it really turns out the way it's being spoken about. And yeah, I mean, very hopeful for that.
All right, final word to Anuj then. Of course, we've spoken a lot about a whole host of things, but in the end, it is the margins that the companies need to protect. They have to do business for returns. And affordable housing, there's a lot of thrust on that. Are developers managing to get the traction on that particular bit and on the otherwise residential area? Everybody needs a house, but still we are finding it difficult to push down that kind of a demand. So what is it that is lacking, and do we see changes really happening on ground?
Yeah, I think a lot of it has been answered, Nisha, by Sanjay, because I would say is much of it is to do with infrastructure. And, you know, I gave those examples of Ahmedabad and Hyderabad and Noida, where there is infrastructure, land prices have come down. It is very affordable. So I clearly see is that whilst we may do whatever we want to say about, you know, bringing down the profits of the developers or, you know, try to bring down the construction price or the marketing cost, I don't think it is going to make significant impact. I think it is really that infrastructure that needs to. Second, I think Khushru said a very important point is that the government needs to be proactive as well to be able to go out and give the approvals, because you know, just sitting on a land that you bought for 18 months without getting approvals does escalate the land price. That needs to be done. Third is, to your point, is I think the margins which the developers were used to, Nisha, of 25-30%, they've sort of now gone away. This is going to become an industry. This is going to become an institutional play. This is for serious players to come in. And just like any other manufacturing, where you have lower margins, the margins will be higher than manufacturing because the risk is higher. Mm. But it will stabilize, not at that 30% level. I think it will be sort of high teens to sort of low 20s.
All right, so many important points really coming in. Consolidation is naturally happening, as Anuj also summed up. And there are many good things as well happening, like smart city and infrastructure development. And probably these are long-haul processes and will start showing results in some time from now. We cannot be myopic in our view, but that's how I would sum it, that many things need to be done, but on ground a lot of things and action is taking place. Thanks so much for being a great audience, being so patient, and thanks to our esteemed guests. Thank you.